Waveguide discontinuities are used where the reflected signals needs to be attenuated. So whenever we pass on some signal, whenever we are passing on the microwave signals, practically it is not possible that whatever this signal that we have sent will perfectly reach the destination. Practically it's not possible. There will be some losses in the medium, and in some cases if matching was not done perfectly, that means whatever the components that we are connecting them each other, if any one of that particular component is not matched properly, then whatever the signal that we have sent, there can be a chances that that signal can be reflected back. So if the reflections, such kind of reflections are happening, then that system is said to be a bad system. So in order to eliminate those kind of reflections, waveguide discontinuities are used. So this in waveguides, waveguide discontinuities are used for matching purpose. As I'm telling you that reflection should be avoided. In order to avoid those kind of reflections, these kind of waveguide discontinuities should be used. So there are different types of waveguide discontinuities. First one is waveguide windows, tuning screws, posts and matched loads. All these are comes under waveguide discontinuities only. And now we'll first look into the waveguide windows. So in waveguide windows, these waveguide windows, they can also be called as waveguide irises or irises. I'm not sure about its pronunciation. I'm calling it as irises. So these waveguide windows can also be called as waveguide irises, where waveguide windows are nothing but conducting plates inserted through the walls into the guided section. These are widely used for matching purpose at microwave frequencies. So these waveguide windows are waveguide irises. They are most widely used waveguide discontinuities, especially at the microwave frequencies. So its susceptance can be varied by varying the alignment or by varying its size. So following are the different types of the waveguide windows. So first one is the inductive window, second one is capacitive window, and third one is the resonant window. So now whatever this diagram that you are seeing on the screen, it is an inductive window. So this line, the outer line, it simply represents the waveguide, and this inner line, that represents the conducting plates. So this equivalent circuit is this one. That means it is nothing but an inductive window. An inductive window allows a current to flow where none flew before. The window is placed in such a way position that the magnetic field is strong. So here you need to place this inductive window within the rectangular waveguide in such a way that the magnetic field must be strong. As the plane of polarization of electric field is parallel to the plane of window, the magnetic field is set up due to the current flow. Hence, energy is stored, as it is an inductive window, the energy is stored in the form of magnetic field, and there is an increase in inductance at that point of waveguide. The amount of susceptance produced depends on the window insertion depth. To what extent you have inserted your window, based on the depth of insertion, the susceptance can be varied. Susceptance increases with the depth. If insertion is made from both the side walls, that window is called a symmetrical one. That means if it is inserting from both side walls, left side and right side wall, then that is said to be a symmetrical window. If the insertion is from either of one wall, either the left side wall or the right side wall or top wall or bottom wall, if you are inserting your window from either of these four walls, then that a particular window is said to be asymmetrical window. So in inductive window, we need to keep one point in our mind, that the magnetic field should be maximum. I mean, that magnetic field that will be induced will be maximum whenever you are placing your window in parallel to the electric field. So coming to this capacitive window is placed in a position where electric field is strong. So capacitive windows are extending into the rectangular waveguide, either from top or bottom or both the walls, and these can be produced capacitive susceptance across the waveguide at shunted points. Windows depth decides the amount of susceptance. The same concept just like whatever we have discussed in inductive windows also, in capacitive windows also, based on the depth of insertion of the window, the amount of susceptance will be varying. And in capacitive windows, they store the energy in the form of electric field. But the disadvantage with this capacitive windows is that they may cause the lowering of breakdown voltage and consequent reduction in maximum power transmission through the waveguide. This is the disadvantage with the capacitor window. And next, the third type of window is nothing but a resonant window. So that means in resonant window, we are going to insert both inductive type window and capacitive type window. So based on the structure of insertion, this is what the equivalent circuit. Here if you observe this circuit, here both capacitor and inductor both are in parallel, and here both are in series. So the inductive and capacitive windows, if combined, as I told you, if first two types of windows they are combined suitably, the inductive and capacitive reactances introduced will be equal, and the window becomes a parallel resonant circuit, a series resonant window which is transparent to the flow of microwave energy. So based on how you are inserting your capacitive window and inductive window into this rectangular waveguide at a time, based on that you might be getting either a parallel resonant window or a series resonant window. So this is about the resonant windows. So for dominant mode, the windows present high impedance, they will provide the high impedance and the negligible shunting effect. Other modes are completely attenuated, and resonant window acts as a bandpass filter to suppress the unwanted modes. So resonant window, it can act as a bandpass filter. What is bandpass filter? Bandpass filter, it allows only particular range of frequencies to pass through it. So by making use of this resonant window as a bandpass filter, we can avoid the unwanted signals. So it can give zero susceptance at chosen frequencies whose value depends on the dimensions of window. It acts as a bandpass filter at this centered frequency. On either side of this center frequency, it produces inductive susceptance on one side and it can produce capacitive susceptance, because it is the combination of inductor and capacitor, right? So it can produce the inductive susceptance as well as it can produce the capacitive susceptance also. So coming to its disadvantages, they are not adjustable and provide fixed susceptance. That means I have explained three conditions the first condition is that they should be adjustable based on the application. So here is the disadvantage of resonant window, is that they are not adjustable and the susceptance is also fixed. That is the first disadvantage. And second disadvantage is it is difficult to maintain the perfect contact without discontinuity between window and walls of the waveguide. This is the second disadvantage with the resonant window. So we have seen one kind of discontinuities like windows, and the another kind of discontinuities are tuning screws. Tuning screws are used in waveguides for impedance matching. Of course, all the waveguide discontinuities they are used in for impedance matching. And the second is that for generating a large SWR over the line, where SWR stands for standing wave ratio, in order to facilitate measurement of high SWR in the laboratory. So tuning screws, they are now using for two purposes. One is they are used for matching purpose, and another is that they are used for the measurement of high SWR. Tuning screws are adjustable, whereas resonant windows are not adjustable. That is the disadvantage. So that particular disadvantage can be overcome by making use of the tuning screws, because they are adjustable. Tuning screw is a metallic threaded rod, and when inserted into the rectangular guide, either from top or bottom, they must be parallel to the E field and can give variable amount of susceptance. So we have two disadvantages with the windows. They are not adjustable and they are providing the fixed susceptance. So those two can be overcome by the screws. So screws are nothing but threaded rods. An adjustable post, so that is about the screws. An adjustable post is called as a tuning or an adjustable screw. An adjustable post is called as a tuning screw or adjustable screw. So here are its structures and their equivalent circuits. So here you can observe the structures that. So if you are inserting your screw, this is the screw. If you are inserting the screw and this is the insertion length, what is the amount of insertion length? That is less than lambda g by 4. So if you are inserting your screw in such a way that the distance in which it was inserted is lambda g by 4, then that is going to be equivalent to a capacitive window. And if you are inserting your screw equals to lambda g by 4, that means if the insertion length or the penetration length, if the penetration length is lambda g by 4, then that is going to act as a series combination of inductor and the capacitor. And if it is greater than lambda g by 4, or if it is completely penetrated, fully penetrated into this rectangular waveguide, then that is going to act as an inductor. Less than lambda g by 4, it is resulting the capacitor. Equals to lambda g by 4, it is resulting the series combination of inductor and the capacitor. Greater than lambda g by 4, or if it is completely, whatever the length of rectangular waveguide we have, equal to that length, if the penetration length is there, then in that scenario, it is going to resemble the inductor. So susceptance, as I am telling you that susceptance depends upon depth of penetration. It depends on the depth of the penetration. And next, these are all what? When depth of penetration is lambda g by 4, then screw will produce the inductive susceptance, as I explained you in just now. And next, we'll be talking about the post. So here also the same concept. Susceptance can be varied by varying the diameter of the post or by varying the penetration length. Here also, if the penetration of post is less than lambda g by 4, then that is going to produce the capacitive susceptance. And if the penetration of post, if it is greater than lambda g by 4, or if it is equals to the lambda g by 4, then it is going to produce the inductive susceptance. And if it is equals to lambda g by 4, if it is equals to lambda g by 4, then in that scenario, then it is going to produce the resonant susceptance. That is what dictated in the form of points. Okay. And if the post is thicker, effective Q will be lowered and can act as a bandpass filter. So here, this post can also act as a bandpass filter, similar to a window when it was thicker. Next, the third type is matched loads or the matched terminators. These are also the waveguide discontinuities only. So matched terminations or matched loads are also used to avoid the reflections and for the matching components. In a waveguide system, it is not possible to attach fixed resistive load as terminations. So a variety of matched terminations are given below. First one is, so if you observe this here, what is happening? A graphite sand at the end of waveguide as shown below can dissipate energy to achieve the SWRs of less value. We are making use of the screws and posts in order to measure the high SWR, right? So in order to measure the lower SWRs, this is how the matched load should be inserted into this particular rectangular waveguide. And second type is a resistive rod placed at a point in the waveguide where electric field strength is maximum. So this is another way how you can keep the load into this particular waveguide. So the second condition is saying that in second condition we need to make sure that the electric field strength should be maximum. And third one is a wedge of resistive material, that is nothing but a powdered iron. The resistive material that I'm talking about here, it can be a powdered iron, carbon, that should be mixed with a binder deposited on the dielectric strip. That is the third one. And fourth one is a permanent metal plate welded at the end of the waveguide may be employed for the complete reflection. So this is nothing but permanent metal plate that was fixed to the rectangular waveguide in order to eliminate the reflection. So this is about the waveguide discontinuities. We have seen all the four types of waveguide discontinuities, and next we are moving on to the waveguide attenuators for perfect matching. And if in case whatever the discontinuities that we have discussed till now, they are placed, means they assure you that there are no reflections. But even after placing the waveguide discontinuities also, if there occurs reflections, then what we need to do? We need to make sure that if reflections are occurring, we need to make sure that those reflections are not coming back to the source of the microwave signal. So in order to oppose those reflections, in order to absorb those reflections, we need to make use of the attenuators. So attenuators are used in order to attenuate the reflections within the microwave setup, and that attenuation can be given in dB, whereas attenuation in dB is given by 10 log of Pi by P0, input power to the output power. Okay, and coming to the applications, attenuators are most widely used. There are different types of applications, like measuring the power gain and for providing the isolation between the instruments. Providing isolation means providing isolation to the instruments from the reflected waves, reducing the power input to particular stage to prevent the overloading, providing the signal generators with the means of calibrating their outputs accurately so that precise measurement could be made. All these applications means the single point. Wherever you are making use of the attenuators in microwave test bench, there these attenuators will isolate those devices from the reflected waves. That's it. Next, coming to this classification of the attenuators, there are two types of attenuators: fixed attenuators and variable attenuators. Fixed attenuators are used where fixed amount of attenuation is required. A resistive card attenuator is example for the fixed attenuator, and variable attenuators are used wherever you want to introduce the variable amount of attenuation, there variable attenuators are used. And this fixed card, look at this, resistive card attenuators, there are two types. These resistive card attenuators can be fixed attenuators, or resistive card can be variable attenuators. So resistive card attenuators, we have two types. One is fixed resistive card attenuator, and second one is variable resistive card attenuator. So variable resistive card attenuator is also called as flap type attenuator, or it can also be called as vane type attenuator. And the another example for variable attenuator is rotary vane. Another one is rotary vane. And now we will look into this first type. What is the first type? Resistive card attenuator. This resistive card attenuators, they can be either fixed type or they can be variable type. I have mentioned here fixed resistive card, and this one is the variable resistive card. Resistive card is basically a glass that is coated with carbon or the aquadog. Whatever the this particular lines you can observe here and here, that is basically a glass that is coated with a carbon or the aquadog metal. So resistive card attenuators have two versions. One can provide fixed amount of attenuation, as I told you just now, and another can provide variable amount of attenuation. So these resistive attenuators, they are not highly accurate, and they are cheaper, and they are frequency dependent. The advantage with this resistive card is that it is cheaper, but the disadvantage is that whatever the output that we are getting from this resistive card attenuator, that's not accurate, and it is frequency dependent. So now we'll be looking into the fixed type resistive card. So in fixed type resistive card attenuators, the resistance card is tapered at both ends. Tapering means making narrower, thinga cheyadam anamata. So it will be tapered at both ends. The tapering of the card helps in reducing the reflections, so as to keep the SWR low at the input as well as the output ports over the useful waveguide frequencies. So when we make this tapering, that means when you are making narrow dimensions to this particular resistive card, then it will be helpful in keeping the low SWR both at the input and at output ports. So for dominant mode, the card is placed parallel to the electric field and at the center of the waveguide so as to achieve the maximum attenuation for unit guide length. Attenuation provided by fixed resistive card is a frequency dependent, where it should be a frequency independent. For if, in order to call this as a good attenuator, the amount of attenuation should be independent of the frequency. So that is about the fixed resistive card type. And a variable resistive card, which can also be called as flap attenuator, which can also be called as vane attenuator. In flap attenuator, the resistive card enters into the waveguide through the slot provided in the broader wall, thereby intercepting and absorbing the portion of the wave. Depth of penetration of resistive card is varied with the help of hing arrangement, and typically the attenuation is changed from 0 dB to 30 dB. So you can vary your attenuation in variable attenuators from 0 dB to 30 dB. So what are the disadvantages of this flap attenuators? The disadvantages with flap attenuators is that attenuation is a function of frequency and phase of the output signal is function of attenuation. As I told you, this resistive card, it is its attenuation, it depends upon the amount of it depends upon the frequency. If it is depending upon frequency, then the amount of attenuation is going to vary, where that is said to be a disadvantage in some applications. So the next type is a rotary vane attenuator, whereas this rotary vane attenuator is a variable attenuator type. So rotary vane attenuators are very accurate and frequency independent but relatively expensive. So these rotary vane attenuators, they are independent of frequencies, and whatever the output that they are going to generate, that output is going to be very accurate. But only one disadvantage is that it is expensive. So coming to the structural details, it consists of two fixed circulator waveguide sections and are identical in all the respects on either side. See here. So these two are the circular waveguides. Till now we have come across the rectangular waveguides, right? But this rotary attenuator, it makes use of circular waveguides. These two are the fixed circular waveguides, whereas this circular waveguide can be rotatable. It can be a rotatable. And to this particular attenuator, the input is provided through the rectangular waveguide only. Internally, it has the circular waveguides, but input is provided through this rectangular waveguide, and output is also collected across the rectangular waveguide only. So between these two rectangular waveguides, it is entering through the rectangular waveguide and it is coming out of the rectangular waveguide, but in between it is passing on through the circular waveguides. That is what explained in this structure. Okay, the plane, these two fixed circulator waveguides are attached to the variable. Just now I have explained variable or the rotatable circular waveguide, which has a lossy dielectric plate lying horizontal on it. And the plates are normally with epsilon r greater than 1 and mu r is equals to 1. And conductivity is of a non-zero value. We are not sure about how much we are going to get the conductivity, but we can say that it is a non-zero value. So the plate attenuates the traveling wave. The amount of attenuation depends upon the properties of the material with which the plate is made up of, and the dimensions of that particular plate, or we can call it as a slab, and the angle between the plane of plate and the E vector of the waveguide. So based on these three parameters, the amount of attenuation will be depending. If E vector of the wave is perpendicular to the plane, then wave is not attenuated. If electric field vector, if it is perpendicular to that particular plane, then wave is not attenuated. But if it is parallel to that, then wave is going to be attenuated. To get the amount of attenuation, the length of the pole is determined. Length of the plate, sorry, the length of the plate is determined. And coming to the analysis, the amount of attenuation that can be given by A is equals to 10 log of 1 minus 1 by cos square theta m, whereas theta m is nothing but angular rotation of the rotatable section. The wave does not get attenuated when electric field is vertical and crosses the input fixed section of the plate. The unattenuated wave at the input of the rotatable section with a rotating angle of theta m can be resolved into two components. One is parallel to the rotatable plate and another one is perpendicular to the rotatable plate. Parallel components gets absorbed almost completely, attenuated by this plate, whereas perpendicular component, that is nothing but e cos theta m, crosses without the attenuation. That is the reason in the output you are going to have e cos theta m component. E cos theta m exists at the input of the fixed output section. This component again can be resolved into two. One is the horizontal and the another one is the vertical. And horizontal component will be absorbed and vertical component will come out without any attenuation. So for the at one place, it is coming out as e cos theta m, and this e cos theta m is again made into two portions, horizontal portion and the vertical portion. So the vertical portion will come out without any attenuation. So cos theta m and cos theta m. So at the end we are going to have cos square theta m. So from that analysis, A can be given as 10 log of 1 minus cos square theta m. So this is about the rotary vane attenuators. So coming to the advantages of this, attenuation is provided by this device depends only on the rotating angle theta m, and it is independent of frequency and it produces accurate output. So this is about the variable attenuator. Okay. Guys, are you clear with the today's topic? Students, are you there, ma'am? Okay, it is time up. I'm going to share this. C3, can you provide your roll number to me? Sorry, mobile number to me, so that I'll share you the material of today's class. Can you ping it to my WhatsApp number?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
Classes regularly without fail. If you are not attending classes, you are unable to understand the topics.